In our daily lives, we make number of choices. Some of these choices are monetary, meaning these choices involve money. And some of these choices are non-monetary, meaning they don't involve money. All these choices are driven by some factors. What we inherently desire in a given point in time dictate the choices we make. But that's the half story. These choices are also dictated by the limitations we have. Limitations on purchasing capacity, the priorities we have, and other constraints coming from different external aspects put a ceiling on our wishes. Economics take both sides of the coin in consideration. The wishes we have and the limitations imposed on us influence our economic activity. So in short, economics is the study of choices. When you go out for shopping, we have a list of items in our wish list. Items on this wish list yield different benefits for us. And on the other hand, we have a budget to spend. Depending on the benefits we want to get and constraints we face, we make choices we deem as optimal. At a similar budget, the choices can vary depending on individuals' preferences. Apart from these monetary transactions, how we spend our day can also be viewed under the lenses of economics. Money, time, energy all fall under the rule of scarcity and optimum allocation. When you zoom out further and look at this individual, an economic agent interacting with other economic agents, with different or similar sets of choices, we can get a sense of what the market is. These interactions based on all the choices of all the economic agents make up the market. In a free market, when there is an agent who wants to purchase a stuff, there is also an agent who wants to sell this stuff. In a usual circumstance, the seller wants to sell it because he knows he can sell the stuff he produced or purchased at a price above the cost of the product. At what markup the seller will be able to sell the product will depend on how many buyers want the product. If large number of buyers find value in owning or using the product will be high in demand. That means the seller can add high markup. If it's the opposite, then there is low markup. In buyer's perspective, the incentive goes the other way around. A low price of a particular product incentivizes the buyers to buy more, and high price incentivizes buyers to demand less. Again, the rule of scarcity and what one desires come into play. If we put these both perspectives of buyers and sellers in a graph, then we get the law of supply and demand. Obviously, there are cases that violate this standard law, but those events are often deemed as anomaly or special situations. These price-driven incentives dictate the quantity of production and quantity of specific products consumer demand. Some products' demand and supply is more sensitive to price than others. As we are discussing about price-driven incentives, we need to remind ourselves that there are other forms of incentives too that influence our economic activity. Now we can zoom out further and see how a country's economy is shaped. A country's economic activity is also limited by its resources and dictated by the policy it takes. A country is governed by a central body which is called the government. The government generates revenue in different forms. Taxes is the primary source. Then government can borrow from commercial banks and foreign institutions as well. Government also borrows money from central bank, and that's where government budget is different from a household budget. A household budget is always limited by its income sources, but government can increase its budget by creating money from thin air. In a fiat currency world, there is practically no limitation in creating money for the government to spend. With cooperation from central bank, the government can easily finance its project by creating additional money in the form of loan from central bank. However, there is limitation in creating money if price stability comes under question because of excessive money supply in the economy. That's why, except any special situation, government is better off by not creating excessive money. There is always a limit on how much a central bank should stimulate the economy by increasing money supply. So even if the government has tools to create money to make its every wish come true, the economics put its natural limitation on it. The government allocates its budget, giving some avenue more priority than the others. In any economic system, the country's government is making choices under the conditions of expected return from each avenue and constraints the economy faces, which include natural resources, labor force, productivity, money supply, etc. Government makes decisions to trade with other countries. Some governments promote free trade while others are selective and few are very restrictive. Surplus production of certain commodities in the country are exported while its scarce commodities are imported. Here, each country acts as economic agent in a large global market where economic interaction between countries shape global economy. So, we come to the conclusion that economics is the study of choices. Economics is also the study of incentives. And economics is the study of interaction between economic agents.